So how did you two meet, and how did you decide to work together to create an exposition that commemorates the First World War?
I've been painting landscapes for about 14 years, and my father was a musician, and I've always been really influenced by music and film, and I love the way that music and film can grab you and pull you out of yourself. And just I wanted people to react to my paintings through emotion and just be something part of their lives that they take away with them forever, you know? And I knew about Mark because of his history, and I really wanted to work with Mark. And I knew that he would have the insight to create something as beautiful as this.
I'm a owner and manager of quite a big management company in London. And Scarlett was kind of pestering me on Facebook to see if I would take on a painter. And I know about art, and I went to art college, but I know nobody in the world of art. But I took a presentation. We were managing Jesse J, and the tech company Blipper came to see me and asked whether I could persuade Jesse J to use the technology to make an album sleeve augmented. She wasn't interested. But then I remembered Scarlett, so I went back to Scarlett and said, do you think we could have a go at doing something interesting? And she said yes, but only if I would work with her on it. So that's how it started.
So which stories from the First World War have influenced this Danger Tree exhibition?
The first story that influenced the exhibition was my granddad's story. Eddie was born in 1898 and he died in 1998. He was a Boy Scout before the war, and that was his army training. They thought that the Boy Scouts training was good enough for him to go straight to the front. So on his 18th birthday, he joined up the Bristol Pals Brigade in the Royal Worcesters in Bristol. And he went straight out to the Battle of the Somme. And he was terribly badly wounded very, very quickly. A piece of shrapnel went through his face and took most of his bottom jaw and his right ear. And he was profoundly deaf for the rest of his life. He was 94% deaf, because the concussion in the left ear had caused him so many problems. So off he went to war, badly wounded. They sent him back to stitch him up and fix him. And after 5 months, they put him straight back on the front line again. And he didn't start talking about his war experiences, which were so horrific, until he was about 85 years old. And for some reason, I was the person that he chose to talk to. And his stories, he used to cry. He was an 85-year-old man. And for the last 15 years, he didn't realize it, because he was probably showing signs of dementia, but he began to repeat the same stories over and over again. And he couldn't talk about who the Prime Minister was or the World Cup football. He could only repeat his World War I stories. And he'd weep whilst he told them. And so I couldn't help but be fully, fully immersed in his stories.
There's a lot of really famous stories, but we really like to concentrate on stories that kind of haven't been heard yet, or haven't been heard as much as they should, and just a voice of someone to we rally around. Each time we have an exhibition in a certain place like Stockton or Manchester, we get a historian involved in the society or the place that we're living in, and we learn about the place, and hopefully we do paintings dedicated to the place, and we get the families involved. They come to the private view.
Where does the title Danger Tree come from?
Danger Tree is a particular battle in the Battle of the Somme. On the 1st of July 1916, whistle blew at 7:30 or whatever it was, and the 800 soldiers of the Newfoundland Brigade were asked to charge towards a German position. And halfway, the halfway mark, there was a tree, one solitary tree, which they knew couldn't hide them, so they called it the Danger Tree. So they all went running towards the Danger Tree, and within 15 minutes, out of 800 men, 760 were dead, because they didn't realize that the machine guns had been using the Danger Tree as its target practice. And there were two machine guns that were just cutting across. So nobody stood a chance. But there was a long tail to the story, because you've got to bear in mind that Newfoundland is the size of Great Britain, but at the time it had only 120,000 people living there. So it sent its finest young men. The first to volunteer were the sons of the businesses that ran the logging business, the fishing business, the shipping business, you know, all the infrastructure, the building businesses. And they all died. So what happened was that when after the war, Newfoundland couldn't repopulate because they'd lost the sons of those businesses, and the country went bankrupt. And this is fact, this is an inescapable fact. The country went bankrupt. And it caused it to no longer be a dominion of Britain. It lost its dominion status and became part of Canada. as a result. So this was a tiny battle that had a massive long tail that we found very moving, because it told you how really micro stories can turn into these giant stories, and that's what we liked.
So poetry, letters and music are key features in the animations, and so how did you go about choosing for them for individual paintings?
Well, I'd studied the war poets at school, so I knew, so that was a great starting point. So I knew my Dulce et Decorum est off by heart because I'd had a blackboard rubber thrown at me and made to learn it. So I knew quite a few of those ones, and so that was a very good starting point. But then when we realised that towns like Stockton were going to be interested in us, we started looking around for local stories. And actually, that was one of the most important things that we could have done. When we found the Liverpool story, that turned into quite a big BBC news piece that actually unearthed relatives of Arthur Senor, who is the chap who wrote the letter home to his mum. And here in Stockton, we've chosen to do a piece on a Stockton boy, George Hunter. And we find actually sometimes focusing in on the anti-heroes, the non-heroes, is more important because the people that won the VCs, their stories are often very well told.
Yeah, so the First World War poet that Mark and my father introduced me to, just it made sense then. It kind of just visually in the senses, and the poetry is people's last words as they're about to go over the top, and they're just about humanity, and it really... every time I read the poem or listen to it, Mark introduced me to the poems being read by Sean Bean and Christopher Eccleston, and just the way they're spitting out their words and the performance visually really helped me and inspired the paintings.
What emotional reaction do you think people will have when they come to this?
Scarlett and I don't try and dictate terms of what people should feel. People cry all the time in these exhibitions, and it's actually amazing for us to understand that people feel the same feelings that we do. But in reality, it could make it sound like the whole thing is full of doom and gloom, and it's not. There's beauty in it, and then there is hope in it. So there's a range of emotions, but what we really want is that people go away just thinking about it, because some of these are big poems and big stories, but most of them actually are stories of small people. And we want them to kind of really rethink the fact that these were ordinary people. We tend to think of the First World War soldiers as professional soldiers, but they weren't. They were bakers, they were bugle players, they were maths teachers, they were chemistry teachers, they were English, they were ordinary people. And so what we want to try and do is have people focus on their very ordinariness.
It's all impressional, and it creates a platform for people to really delve inside their thoughts and who they are within the context and what they think. And I really hope that, I mean, a lot of the reactions, people have been crying, you know, a lot of people are just silent, and some people on the opening night I just saw yesterday just sitting down and just wanting a moment to themselves. So a lot of emotions come from this.
What came first, the paintings or the animations, and how did you bring both elements together?
The very first painting that we did was the only one where we have really done the animation and the painting at the same time. But it took us so long to do that we realised that we had to change our process, otherwise we'd only be able to do about three a year. So there, where in that painting I wanted to introduce elements of photography and things like that, we literally would physically lay them on the painting and then do the stop motion animation with them physically lying on the painting. And it was at that point we realised we just couldn't do it that way and actually make sense of it. But I knew enough about things like green screen and chroma keying that people may have heard of. And literally, I was sitting on a box in Scarlett's. She was painting in a barn, a windy barn with rain pouring in. And I compiled what we had done that morning into a little clip. And then I thought, well, I'll try chroma keying. And I dropped what's called a chroma key on it. She was painting on a blue canvas. And I had already laid underneath, like a sandwich, I'd laid underneath it a piece of World War II German footage, World War I German footage, sorry. Dropped the chroma key on, and then everywhere there was blue, so the floor and where she had sky in the painting, suddenly soldiers popped through. And we thought, oh my God, this is incredible. We're not trained to do it. And we realized from that moment on is that if she carefully used blues and greens where we wanted to tell the story,
we could then really begin to pop things through. So for argument's sake, you were to look at the George Hunter story, the Stockton 1246 painting, you'll see a bit where George's face is there and it's surrounded by red paint. What you wouldn't see is that that red paint is painted actually on green. So I'm able to drop a chroma key on it, bring George's face through, and then just the red paint is left, and then the white paint comes over the top. So that was when we kind of realized that we could split it.
So obviously a few of the paintings look kind of 3D. How much paint did actually go into them?
When I was at university, I had about three jobs to afford the paint, and I'd work an hour waitressing and you'd earn £5 something, and that would be a tube of not very good artist quality paint. And as you can imagine with these paintings here, I'm squeezing out a whole tube in my hand and I'm throwing it onto the canvas. So, and the stem would be one tube squeezing it out. So. Yeah, I don't know why. I always wanted the painting to be sculptural and just grab you, and so a lot of paint.
How long does it take to paint each painting?
I usually work on about 10 paintings at the same time, purely because of the drying process. The work's all about material and layers and all the narrations underneath. And they need a lot of time to settle on their own before the next layer's put on. It takes about 3 months, and on top of all the narrations and all the storyboarding that we do before that, probably about 5 or 6 months for each of the 10 paintings.
So obviously the paintings use augmented reality. In your opinion, what is the future of augmented reality?
I'm a huge fan of a big supporter of the future of augmented reality. The idea of being able to use technology to tell stories is, I think, just fantastic. It seemed so obvious to me, and that we were really surprised to find that we were credited as being the first in the world to do it, because it just seemed so obvious. We still find that we're unique in being storytellers. We tell actual stories. But I think that loads of people will follow on, and this will become a movement. And we call ourselves augmentists, like you've got, you know, the realists or the impressionists. We think we're augmentists.
I really hope, right, it looks like that it's really good taking, it's getting legs and it's becoming something that people are doing. I love the fact that you can hear a painting and you can see. With my paintings, I've always painted with process and movement. And I'm an emotional painter and quite an indecisive painter, so a painting would have layers of different compositions of the sky, of the moon, of the sun, and it would change. You know, some paintings would be poppies and then they'd turn to sunflowers, and I'd be working for months on layers of these paintings. And for years, the viewer has only ever seen the final image. So with augmented reality, you can really access the artist's thought process, the subject matter, and I think that it's worth doing, and I really hope that it carries on, and I think that it will.
So how does the Danger Tree in Stockton compare to other expositions?
This is the first exhibition that has been built for us, where in fact Scarlett and I haven't done the very last minute of planning. Just before we came out to Stockton on the 1st of August, we opened our biggest ever exhibition in Titanic Belfast. That's an incredible £100 million building that's dedicated to technology and history. They came to see our exhibition in Liverpool and realised that we're technology and history too, so we're a perfect fit. There, we've got a huge gallery, which is probably 4 or 5 times the size of this space. And in fact, we struggled in a bit to fill it. We had to split our set apart. This is the first time that somebody's actually built one for us, and we're completely blown away by the effort and the attention to detail that's gone into it. So it may not be the biggest show that we will have, but we think this is absolutely amongst the best.
But it's really funny coming here. I had never been to Belfast. We had an exhibition in Liverpool, Martin Luther King Building. I'd never been to Liverpool, in the Central Library in Manchester. Never been. So I get introduced to each place and the history, because we dedicate a painting and honour the place in which we're exhibiting. And yeah, arriving here, I didn't know what to expect, and I haven't stopped crying.
What are your thoughts on the George Hunter story? He's commemorated in the 1246 painting.
Yeah, I suffer from anxiety, and I've had a lot of breakdowns, and I'm regularly medicated and have therapy once a week, so I can really relate to mental health issues. And to me, he's a complete hero. And the augmented reality and the painting itself is probably one of my favourites. And to have his family here is so moving. So I'm honoured to have met his family and to have learnt about his story. I think he's an incredible man. He was only 25 with two children, and he was just shot dead by his own people for being really, really unwell.
Interesting for us, the George Hunter piece came about because a Stockton resident, Mike Falaise, just happened to come to our exhibition in Liverpool. And Scarlett and I had created a really, really good painting, which is here in the show, one that we're really proud of, called The First and the Last. We wanted to do something on the Powell's Brigade's phenomena. And the Liverpool Powell's Brigade was the very first Powell's Brigade anywhere in the country to be formed, and it was the last to be disbanded. But we wanted to choose, again, one soldier's story to tell a story, a big story of the Powells. And we chose a chap called Arthur Senor. And Mike came and was very moved by that story and bought that painting. And he just happened to, he was so convinced that it was of interest to Stockton that he persuaded Neil Schneider, the chief executive of the council, to come to his home to view it. And that's where the whole conversation started from. So he saw our Liverpool painting and realised that we could do the same for Stockton if we found a story, and boy did we find a story.
Have you any advice for any young artists hoping for a career in art?
I'd say that finding a career in art is really, really difficult. But I've had 40 years at the very top of the music industry. You know, I ran Island Records, I was the boss of U2 for 18 years, and you know, I've had a lot of experience in the creative talents. And that has never put me off working with creative talent because it can be done. So my advice to any artist is to try and find the point of difference between you and everyone else. If everyone else is doing what you're doing, then you're in a crowd. Why put yourself in a crowd? Distance yourself from the crowd and try and do something different.
I'm not particularly skillful in that I can't paint a portrait that I see. I can't replicate things, and that could have deterred me because there were other people in my class that were so much more skillful. I think things that you're not good at, use as a positive. You know, so if you feel insecure about something or your teacher's not being particularly supportive, use that to drive you on. Use that to prove them wrong, you know, and I just don't give up, and I feel like everybody is an artist, and I really don't, really not into people being made to feel that they're better than others. I just think just humanity, the exhibition's about humanity, and just to be alive, and just to make things.
And finally, have you been to Stockton before, and have you enjoyed your visit here?
I've never been to Stockton. I haven't been to many places. And I love it. I'm really, really grateful for Stockton and everything that they've done, and to arrive and everything be set up is just phenomenal, and they've done such an incredible job, and there's amazing ideas that I want to nick that I hadn't even thought of.
Here in Stockton, this is the first time out of six big exhibitions where we feel like we're being welcomed into a place. It's very different, it's a different feeling. We feel very, very welcomed in, and we feel very honoured by that. Feel strongly that you've embraced us, and it's we're really touched.